Welcome back. Today we are going to start with tetanus. Tetanus is a disease which was important and unfortunately which still is important. Tetanus nowadays is not more important in adults, but the prime importance of tetanus has shifted and it is now more important in children. Something called as tetanus neonatorum. Tetanus neonatorum is a grave killer of children, and we are going to see how tetanus affects and how to control it. Tetanus is an acute disease caused by the exotoxin of the bacteria Clostridium tetani. The mortality tends to be very, very high. It is to the range of about 40 to 80%, and the cause of decline was mainly because of significant immunization coverage into the pregnant females. Now here let us straight away put our hands into the topic. The most important intervention if asked for the prevention of neonatal tetanus is the immunization of pregnant females, and that is because of a unique phenomenon of the transference of immunity from the mother to the child. If the mother is immunized against tetanus by tetanus toxoid, the antibodies produced in her body also confer protection to the baby, and this protection does not only last while the baby is in the womb, it is also conferred when the baby is out. So this is a unique method of prevention of disease wherein I am immunizing the mother to immunize the baby. Agent factors: you have Clostridia tetani, which is a gram-positive aerobic anaerobic spore-bearing organism, and they have those classical drumstick appearance that you see on the slides in microbiology. The spores of Clostridium tetani are highly resistant, and this is one of the problems that whenever you injure yourself, you get pricked by a nail, everybody comes to you and says get a tetanus injection, and this tetanus injection is warranted because of the spores. The spores of Clostridium tetani are highly resistant. They are found in the atmosphere, they are rampant in the ground, they are rampant in cow dung or other organic matter, and they can last for a very long time. As you know, they are spores and they can germinate. So the problem of tetanus is that it is a spore bearing organism. Spores are resistant forms of life and can cause disease later on. The reservoir of infection, as I told you, they are abound. It is found in the intestine of man as well as other animals, and sometimes it won't cause any infection even if it is residing into the gut. Age: the high risk group is 5 to 40 years of age, because these are the people who are mostly outside, who play, who work, and therefore are prone for trauma. Coming to neonatal tetanus, it is defined as tetanus in the newborn, and the infants acquire the disease at birth when delivered in aseptic conditions. There are a lot of unhygienic practices as far as delivery is concerned, and one of the worst thing that you can do is application of cow dung to the umbilical cord of the baby. This immediately infects the umbilical cord, and as I told you, Clostridia tetani is present in the guts of animals and humans. It is directly impregnated on the umbilical cord and the child gets tetanus. Fortunately, in India, this practice is severely cut down, and therefore the incidence of neonatal tetanus is also coming down. Sex: it is equally found in both sexes, and it is obviously high in agricultural workers, both because of increased prevalence of injury as well as proximity to sources of Clostridium tetani. Immunity: immunity from two tetanus toxoid injections is highly effective, and it lasts for many years. It is not lifelong, but it definitely lasts for many years. Immunity can be transferred to the baby if the mother is immunized during pregnancy. This is what I told you. This is the logic why we immunize a mother, and the protection is conferred to the baby. And herd immunity is not at all useful here. So an individual's immunity is important. Tetanus is an example wherein herd immunity will not help. Coming to prevention, active immunization. We immunize by tetanus toxoid. There are two preparations available. The first is DPT, diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus. So the third component, the T, is tetanus, and you have a monovalent vaccine, that is the TT, or also called as tetanus toxoid. So you have two preparations, diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus, and the monovalent version is TT or tetanus toxoid. Coming to the passive immunization, temporary immunity can be provided. You have two options here: human tetanus, hyperimmunoglobulin, and anti-tetanus serum. As the name indicates, the first one, human tetanus immunoglobulin, is derived from human sources and is expensive. Therefore, it is better in conferring protection. There are less chances of side effects. As compared to the anti-tetanus serum, it is derived from hyperimmune horses and therefore it is cheap, but the incidence of side effects can be more. Coming to the next disease, that is tuberculosis, a very important disease, a very important public health problem, and the problem is continuing in the future also. We thought that we had dealt with tuberculosis in the last century, and as I told you, we thought that HIV would be the new century problem, but it seems that tuberculosis is in no mood to go away, and tuberculosis has joined hands with HIV now, and we have a renewed problem. Agent of tuberculosis, as you all know by now, is a bacteria called as Mycobacterium tuberculosis. You have both strains, human strain and bovine strain. Fortunately, because of the practice of boiling milk before consumption, bovine tuberculosis is becoming an increasingly rare disease. The sources of infection are the open cases of humans. We will see what these open cases of humans are, and bovine sources, like I told, infected milk. The communicability: patients are infective as long as they remain untreated. But the point to note here is effective treatment can reduce the infectivity by 90% in 2 days. If you compare and contrast this with the treatment of Hansen's disease or leprosy, with rifampicin it took 3 weeks, and look at this, in tuberculosis it only takes 2 days. So tuberculosis can be converted into non-infectious in just 2 days with proper treatment. Coming to the host factors, it affects all ages. In fact, tuberculosis can cause a lot of diseases in a lot of people. So it is said jokingly that except pregnancy, tuberculosis can cause anything. So it causes everything. It affects almost every organ, has a lot of complications and a lot of morbidity associated with it. Sex: males are affected more commonly as compared to females, and tuberculosis is not a hereditary disease. You may think that this is obvious, that tuberculosis is not a hereditary disease, but it is not so obvious to the general population. Many a times people refuse to marry a girl who is from a tuberculous family. Somebody in the family is suffering from tuberculosis and the girl does not get men to marry. So this is important, that tuberculosis in that case is not a hereditary disease. This knowledge is important. Otherwise, tuberculosis can cause a lot of social stigma, as is caused by leprosy. Nutrition: malnutrition predisposes to tuberculosis. Again, they have a synergistic combination. Malnutrition predisposes tuberculosis, and tuberculosis causes malnutrition. Immunity: there is no inherited immunity. The immunity that you get is either you get a natural infection from some of the mycobacteria, or you get the immunization by BCG. Both delayed hypersensitivity and acquired resistance to TB are cell mediated response. Any other disease where this was true? Again, leprosy. Leprosy was also caused by mycobacteria, and we saw that the chief resistance was CMI, or cell mediated immunity. Social factors: TB is often called as a barometer of the social condition of a country. TB is essentially a social disease. As I told, it is a barometer. It is propagated by poor quality of life, overcrowding, population explosion, undernutrition, having large families, early marriages, and lack of awareness. All these factors are contributing factors for the spread of tuberculosis. Coming to the tuberculin test, one of the very important tests. Although the diagnostic value of tuberculin test is invalidated these days, but still questions appear in the examination on this test. Positive reaction to the test is generally accepted as an evidence of past or present infection with Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Please remember the word is infection. The word is not disease. We saw that there is a difference between infection and disease. I told you I am an Indian. Most probably I am infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis. But I do not have Mycobacterium tuberculosis. I do not have the disease. Okay. I got an infection and my body contained the infection. I do not have the disease called as Mycobacterium tuberculosis. For that matter, most of the Indians are infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis. But most of them again do not have the disease. Tuberculin test does not tell me if I have the disease. Tuberculin test tells me if I am infected with the bacteria. There is a difference and it is an important one. It is a basis of a lot many questions and therefore you should surely know this. Two test antigens are used for this test. The old tuberculin and the PPD or the purified protein derivative. You can afford to forget the OT because it is not used anymore. What we use these days is PPD. What PPD is used? WHO recommends the use of this PPD RT23 with twin 80. Should you know this? Yes, you should know because this is high yield. So what purified protein derivative is used? PPD RT23 with twin 80. This is the WHO recommended PPD for tuberculin test. The test is carried out by injecting intradermally on the flexor aspect of the forearm 1 TU of PPD. Now there are different doses of PPD and the different doses are 1 unit and 5 units, sometimes more than 5 units. The teams in India use 1 TU, so we will only be seeing the 1 TU unit. The results are read after 72 hours. And what are the results? If the reaction is more than 10 millimeters, it is said to be positive. If it is less than 6 millimeters, it is said to be negative. And if it is in between 6 to 9 millimeters, then we say that it is doubtful. The reaction is doubtful. So these are the interpretations. What are the modes of transmission? How is TB transmitted from one person to another? It is a respiratory infection and therefore it is transmitted by droplet infection and droplet nuclei. Open cases of tuberculosis, when they go in the community, they cough, they sneeze, or for that matter even they talk, they discharge a large amount of tuberculosis bacilli which then get inhaled by other people and they get the infection. So tuberculosis is spread by droplet infection and droplet nuclei. Coughing obviously generates the largest number of bacilli. The frequency and vigor of cough and the ventilation of the environment is influences the transmission of the disease. So this is one of the factors you should know, that ventilation is an important factor. And therefore we say overcrowding promotes tuberculosis because there is lack of ventilation. If there is adequate ventilation, there is a rare chance that tuberculosis can spread. TB is not spread by formites or dishes. This is important. TB is not spread by formites or sharing dishes. The incubation period, it ranges from 3 to 6 weeks. It depends upon the closeness of the contact, the extent of the disease, the sputum positivity of the source case and the host parasite relationship. This is something like Hansen's. There are too many factors to consider. Not everybody will get the disease, so it depends upon what is the load in the patient, in the primary case. How many tuberculosis bacilli does he have? What stage of treatment is he in? How well controlled the disease is in the patient? And how close is the contact? So there are a lot many factors which determine the spread of tuberculosis to other people. The control of TB. WHO defines that TB control is said to be achieved when the prevalence of natural infection in the age group of 0 to 14 years is of the order of just 1%. Just 1%. And look at the number that we have in India. It is about 40% in India. So we cannot even begin to start to think of elimination of tuberculosis because we have a number which is 40 times higher than that of the elimination number. So tuberculosis is pretty rampant in India, and therefore we have got to go a very long way for elimination of tuberculosis. Case finding. The case, as defined by the WHO, is a patient whose sputum is positive for tubercle bacilli. This is an important definition because this is tested. This is an operational definition. This is a programmatic definition. So a case, if you have to call a person a case, he has to have positive sputum microscopy, which means if you do an AFB for his sputum, you should see those acid fast bacilli which are provisionally taken to be Mycobacterium tuberculosis. That is the definition of case. Case finding should be an intensive and an ongoing program. It should not be intermittent. This is the primary tool we have against tuberculosis. What are the target groups? The target groups are patient with chest symptoms like persistent cough and fever. Coming to the sputum examination per se. Sputum examination enables us to deliver epidemiologically most important cases of pulmonary tuberculosis. Now, why are they epidemiologically most important? Because these cases are not only the sufferers of the disease, but they are also the people who are going to spread the infection to other people. So these are important. We need to filter them out so that not only they are cured, but they stop spreading the infection to other people. It is hypothesized that an open case of tuberculosis in a year can infect about 10 healthy persons by tuberculosis. So this spread of the disease is prevented if I do adequate case finding by sputum examination. What happened to the good old X-ray? X-rays are not very commonly used because X-rays are very non-specific. There are a lot of lesions of tuberculosis, but they appear in the late stages and they are non-specific. The same looking lesion can be caused by a lot of other conditions, and therefore X-ray is not a primary modality. When you think of tuberculosis, automatically an X-ray comes to your mind and you might tick that X-ray is the mode of diagnosis. Please remember, under RNTCP, what we use is not X-ray but sputum microscopy or sputum examination. Under India's DTP, the first priority is given to the direct smear examination of the sputums who come to the hospital with the complaints of, this is important, persistent cough for about 3 weeks, you have continuous fever, there is chest pain and hemoptysis. So these conditions are the HRGs, the high risk groups. If you have a person who has these conditions coming to your OPD, he should be referred to a sputum examination. I'll repeat the conditions once again, as they are important: persistent cough for 3 weeks, continuous fever, chest pain and hemoptysis. These are the conditions which tell me that a person is a high risk group for tuberculosis.